Welcome to Elevate Church. Before we get started today, we'd like to hear from you. If you've been impacted in any way by Elevate, we want to hear about your story. Please email us at mystory@elevatepeople.tv. Thanks and enjoy the message.
What's up, Elevate? How's everybody doing? Come on. Is anybody glad to be in church in the house? Make some noise. Come on. That's what's up. It is good to see everybody. If it is your first time, my name is Brandon Barber. Kristen and I, my wife, sitting right over there, my rib, my boo, my everything. We're the lead pastors here at Elevate. We just want to welcome you. Come on, let's welcome our VIPs one more time, will you, Elevate? We are also one church, two campuses. And we got the Harris County Jail campus watching us today. Come on, let's show them some love. We love you guys. We're so glad you're watching today, and everybody watching by the airways and the podcast as well. We're so thankful. Everybody have a good week? Anybody have just a great week? Yeah. Come on. It's March. The weather feels good. And we got the rodeo. Come on, somebody. We're just missing one thing. And what is that? Football. Not Jesus. Football. Come on. How many need some football in the house? Yeah. That's what I'm talking about. Hey, real quick before I dive into today's message, first of all, how awesome was that worship, huh? Come on, where'd it? Can you give it up for the worship team? These guys just bring it every single week. Real quickly, before I dive into today's message, we have, I mentioned it last week, and I don't know, it must have been the rain or something, because most of y'all didn't come to church. I mean, you go to a football game in the rain, but when it sprinkles outside, oh, I can't go to church. What's up with that? I'm just kidding. We love you anyways. All right. But we wanted to pitch it one more time this week. We've been here, those of you that are new, Elevate Church, we're a church plant. We've been around about 16 months now going on. It's been a little bit over a year. Come on, can we give it up for that? And so we're in this community center called the Forge for Families, and we absolutely love it here. Is this not a beautiful facility or what? Yeah, I mean, a gorgeous community center, the best thing in Third Ward, in my opinion. Well, the great thing is that they're allowing us to continue to grow in here, and we can grow as a church and do multiple services, which is awesome, but they're growing as well, which is great, right? We want that. And so we pitched it last week, and I'm gonna mention it again this week, but our Elevate Kids, we've been 0 to 5-year-olds, we've been over in the other building across the street, some of you, or many of you probably dropped your kids off, starting next week, somebody shout next week. Next week, Elevate Kids will not be over there anymore. Elevate Kids will actually be in this building. As soon as you walked in, it's called the gathering place. It's right behind where you checked your kids in. Right behind that, there's a big room. We're going to transition that into our younger Elevate Kids. And what I ask you to do, how many know we're growing this church together? Amen. We started this church not to serve a couple, but to serve a vision. Amen. And we're in this thing together. And so I bragged on you. This transition as a church, it's going to cost us $10,000. Now, because of your awesome tithing, you guys, I bragged on you last week. I'm going to brag on you this week. You've been an incredibly giving and tithing church. Give yourselves a hand on that. You've been over and above. And because of that, we were able to save $5,000. And I challenged you last week, we just needed $5,000 more to meet the budget. Well, we almost got there. We got about $1,800 to $2,000 left. Isn't that awesome? Come on, can we give it up for that? And so we had a video last week to show you guys, because we wanted to paint the picture in front of you of how much we care about our Elevate Kids. And starting next week, this is what you're going to see whenever you walk in to church. Check it out.
I am a masterpiece in your eyes, in your eyes. I am a masterpiece in your eyes. In your eyes, I am a masterpiece. In your eyes, in your eyes, I am a masterpiece. In your eyes, in your eyes,
I am a masterpiece. In your eyes.
Come on, let's give it up for our Elevate Kids. Yeah. Is that not awesome? Yeah. We want to give you guys a good picture of where we're heading as a church. And starting next week, we're going to get that. So I challenged you last week and asked you to pray about. Help us make this happen. And above your tithes and offering, every single one of you got an envelope in your seat. We need just 2,000 more to make this thing happen next week. You got an Elevate Kids sticker, which will symbolize that you want to give a little bit. Anything will help. And you can just drop it off in the giving bucket. You can also give online. There's a kids button that you can donate to help make this transition happen. How many know that the future of our church is the generation right now? Amen? We need to believe in investing in our kids. Our biggest vision in this church is with our kids. And so I'm asking you just to pray about on your way out. Just give a little bit in the offering bucket, a little bit more today so we can make this happen. Amen? Y'all give it up one more time for our kids, can you? Awesome. Awesome stuff. If you got your Bibles, turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 14 and put a bookmark in Ephesians chapter 6. 1 Corinthians chapter 14 and Ephesians chapter 6. When you're there, shout, yeah. Some of y'all quit. We're finishing a series that we've been going over the last 4 weeks called it's been on the Holy Spirit, and it's called Help. Somebody shout, Help! Help. Anybody need some help? Yeah, those ain't raising the hands, they need the most, right? All right. We need some help, so we got to get to know the helper, amen? And just real quickly, I want you to know that the message that I'm going to dive into today is something that we've walked through together. It's not like something we learned just last week. We're talking about the Holy Spirit. This isn't something I learned last week, and I'm just bringing it to you today. I mentioned it to you from the age of 8 years old. I was baptized in the Holy Spirit, and this is something we believe in from the beginning of our church. Amen? And so, but the topic we're going to talk about today, you got to understand, if you've not been with us over the last month, this is what I encourage you to do. Go back and listen to the podcast. See how we have walked together as a church, because here's the bottom line. Many of us have seen the Holy Spirit misused and abused. And we've not seen it in its purest form, amen? We walked through as a church together over these last 4 weeks, and we're going to finish it today, of who the Holy Spirit is. In fact, just a quick recap, we've been answering questions. Week one, we answered, who is he? Who is this guy? In other words, until we understand the fullness of who he is, we got to get to know who he is, amen, right? How many know he is God? That's what we learn. His name is God. Then we ask the second week, the question is he a person? Yeah, he's not just this floating conscience God's voice floating around in my head like, who is this dude? No, he is an actual person, and he desires to have a personal relationship with you and me. Amen? And then last week we talked about, does he baptize? And we broke that down as well. This week, again, here's my challenge to you is that this subject is very sensitive in a lot of churches because it's been misused and abused. And again, I'm going to be talking about a subject that we've walked through together these last 3 weeks. But here's the question I want to answer today. This is kind of part two of what I talked about last week is this. Does he speak in tongues? You can write it down. You got sermon. I think we have some sermon notes. We may be out in some areas, some sermon notes in the middle of your aisles. But if you're not, you can follow along with us. But here, the title of my sermon is this, does he speak in tongues? We're going to pray that the Holy Spirit is going to move. We're going to learn about who he is, because how many know any gift from God is a good gift? Can I get an amen? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we worship you. Holy Spirit, we thank you. Take over in Jesus' name. This is your time. This is your message, God. And we give you all the glory, and we give you all the honor. And help the Houston Rockets in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Amen. I just got real unspiritual with you real quick, didn't I? Come on, give it up one more time for God's word. That was real weak. Come on, give it up for God's word, yeah. Amen, amen, amen. What I want to talk to you about today is answer the question, does he speak in tongues? In other words, I want to talk to you about, this is a gift from God, amen, right? This is a gift from God. But I want to also approach it that is also, I want to talk about, it's maybe not necessarily the gift of tongues, but it's an act of grace. It's an act of grace with it. In 1 Corinthians 14, which we're going to begin breaking down in a second, Paul goes on to describe that there's a difference between the public gift and the private gift. There's a difference between the public use and the private use. In other words, if it's done in public, then it needs an interpretation, right? But every believer can have a heavenly prayer language personally and privately. Every single person can do that. And we're going to learn about this today as we break down scripture. Let me just answer the question I kind of already did earlier, but does Elevate believe in speaking in tongues? Yes, we do. We believe in anything that's going to help you. Amen? That's what we believe in. But I want to discuss this phrase that has been thrown around that I, to be quite honest, I don't really like it that much. And it's the phrase simply this, because it can be used as an argument more than an experience. Are you following me, all right? And that's the phrase, you have received the baptism of the Holy Spirit with the initial physical evidence of speaking in tongues. In other words, if you ain't got the evidence of, then you ain't got the Holy Spirit. Are you following me, right? And here's the deal. Let me just give you a quick history lesson. Back in 1904, there was a revival in Wales. They call this the Welsh Revival. And in 1906, it began breaking out into different areas around the nation. We know it as most popular as Azusa Street in Los Angeles. Y'all know what I'm talking about, all right? And so this is the Welsh Revival. Now, at this time, it was a powerful moment where the Spirit of God began breaking out. People were baptized in the Holy Spirit, and they began speaking in tongues and prophesizing. But then there was a gentleman named William C. Moore. He began to preach and speak on tongues in the initial experience that every person receives. But then, how many know the devil don't want us to have this? Amen? He don't want you to understand the power of God that's going to be a benefit for you. And it's just like the devil. At this moment, when he began to speak on this topic, immediately the enemy threw in a spirit of debate. And all of a sudden, what you found is that each one of these revivals in the early 1900s, they began arguing this point more than having the experience of anything else. How many know if the devil can get you to argue the Holy Spirit instead of experience the Holy Spirit, he's already won in your life? Amen? And so they begin, the devil threw in this spirit of debate, and all of a sudden, they begin splitting and dividing. And by the way, this is where some of our main denominations came out of. The Assemblies of God came out of this. United Pentecostal came out of this movement, and the Church of God came out of this movement. Do you see where the enemy loves to come in? And he immediately created division through denomination and belief, trying to throw confusion into something that is so pure that God wants you to have. Are you following me, all right? And so you got this. This is the moment. This is when he began preaching about that, when they begin arguing, that's when that phrase, the evidence of, began to become in part of every single conversation. That's when, I believe, church, when the Holy Spirit became a pressure on people. In other words, the presence of the Holy Spirit, to be baptized in the Holy Spirit, speaking in tongues and prophesying. In other words, from that moment, the pressure, it became more of a pressure than a desire. It became more of a force than a desire, right? And maybe some of you, maybe you've been around those settings. I don't know about some of y'all and how you grew up, but I grew up in a church. I didn't grow up in a church, but I've been a part of some churches to where the Holy Spirit was like almost forced. Like, you ain't leaving this altar till you start speaking in tongues, boy. Ha! Anybody grow up like that? You know what I'm talking about, right? All right. I'll never forget, I was talking to one of my friends, and he was at the altar, and the pastor was like, you ain't leaving till I start hearing you speak in the Holy Ghost. Ha! It's going to happen. And he's sitting there like, I want to leave. And he's feeling pressured. Now, it's not that he didn't believe in it. He just wasn't quite at that desired point. Are you feeling me, all right? And I'll just never forget. He said he was sitting at the altar, and he was feeling forced on him, and he didn't know what to do. So the quickest thing he can come up with, he worked at a car dealership. He went, shoulda bought a Honda, but I bought a Kia. Shoulda bought a Honda, but I bought a Kia. The pastor said, you got it. And he was like, hallelujah. And he went on out the church and got him some tacos. You know what I'm saying, all right? And so he just threw out whatever he could, okay? Here's my point, okay? Is that most of you grew up where you saw this gift or gifts misused or abused in the church. But there's very few that grew up in a very balanced theological home and church to where you saw this gift performed and used in its purest form. God wants us to have this, and he desires it for you and for me. Amen? Last week, we broke down that every person needs three baptisms. And I challenge you with this question. Do you only have two baptisms? Every person needs three baptisms. First, the Holy Spirit baptizes us into the body of Christ. That's called what? Salvation, right? Every person needs to get saved, amen? By the way, salvation is the only thing that's going to get you to heaven. Can we go ahead and make that clear, amen? Come on with it. But these are desired gifts that God wants you to have. Three baptisms that every person needs. Holy Spirit baptizes us into the body of Christ. You got water baptisms, but then when we broke down last week, there's another baptism, and it says Jesus wants to baptize us, what? In the Holy Spirit. So I got 3 points for you today to answer the question, does he speak in tongues? The Holy Spirit wants to pray with you and through you. Can I get an amen in the house? Number one is this. It's scriptural. It's scriptural. 1 Corinthians 14, verse 2 says this. For he who speaks in a tongue does not speak to men, but to who? To God. For no one understands him. However, in the Spirit, he speaks mysteries. So he says in his word right here, speaking in tongues is what? Speaking in the Spirit. Somebody shout, in the Spirit. I want you to remember that, because every time, whenever we read the rest of the Bible today, we flip through it together. When you see that, this is what he's referring to. Amen? All right? He says, when you speak in tongues, you're speaking in spirit. But what does he say? You're talking to God, not to man. So this is when you go back and you read 1 Corinthians 14, this is what Paul was trying to communicate to the Corinth church. He was saying, understand but the difference between the public gift and the private use. You with me? All right, the private grace, you could say. So this is what was happening then. In other words, it's mistranslated to where it's saying, Paul is saying that it's only for that time that we don't need it. But actually what he's saying is that demonstrating the difference between the public and the private use. So this is what was happening in the church. Somebody would come up and be like, hey, how you doing? And then those that were baptized in the Spirit would go, shoulda bought a Honda, bought a Kia. Shoulda bought a Honda, bought a Kia. And they was like, what you talking about, man? And it was very confusing. So Paul was like, no, you got this wrong, man. You got this wrong. That's why he said, yeah, there's a private use and a public use. Do you remember where it says in that chapter, Paul says, I would rather you speak 5 words that everybody understands, right, than 10,000 that nobody understands. That doesn't mean it's not for you. That just means you need to understand it in its proper use. Amen? You with me? Okay. You need this in your life. But he said, understand the difference between the public gift and the private use. You could say the private gift of grace. Look in your Bibles at 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse 14. You're already there. It says this. It says, for if I pray in tongues, my spirit is praying, but I don't understand what I'm saying. Well then, what shall I do, they ask. It says, I will pray in the spirit and, what does and mean? Two things, right? And I will pray in words I understand. I will sing in the spirit and I will also sing in words I understand. For if you praise God only in spirit, how can those who don't understand you praise God along with you? How many know anytime you pray, it's not to isolate somebody else. It's always supposed to build somebody up, right? Amen? That's the power of being a Christian. You bring people with you. You don't turn them away. And so it says, how will they know that? Verse 17, you will be giving thanks very well, but it won't strengthen the people who, what? Hear you. Again, what is he explaining? He's explaining the difference between the public use and the private use. It goes on to say, though, it says, It goes on to say, right, this is Paul talking, right? This is Paul, the greatest apostle of all time. By the way, this dude wrote 1/3 of the New Testament. That's 1/3 more than you or me ever wrote. You know what I'm saying? All right. This dude was the best and greatest apostle of all time. How many would agree if Jesus needed it and if he needed it, how many would say, church, we need it? Amen. He was the great. He said, you need this in your life. But pastor, he says, if I pray in tongues. No, if means that it's a choice, which we'll get into that a little bit later. He actually says in verse 18, I thank God that I speak in tongues more than any of you, more than all of you do. He goes on to say, my spirit prays, but my understanding is unfruitful. I don't understand. I will pray with the Spirit, and I will pray with understanding. If you read this, remember, what does that word "and" means? It means two things are going to take place, right? He says, if I pray in the Spirit, I'm not going to understand, because it's a prayer to God, right? This is your red phone to God, your direct link to God. But he says, when I pray in the Spirit, and I will pray in understanding. In other words, what is he saying? He does both. He does both, and we need both, right? He says, I'm going to pray in the Spirit. By the way, what does "in the Spirit" mean? Help me out, church. Come on, help me preach a little bit, all right? It means tongues, right? When he says, I pray in the Spirit, that means he prays in tongues, which is a heavenly prayer language. And I also pray in understanding, which means what? For us, that is English. That means I pray in English and I pray in the Spirit. He needed both. Jesus needed both. That means what? We need both. First point is scriptural. Second thing is this. It's a benefit. It's a benefit. Look in the same chapter, 1 Corinthians 14, verse 4. It's a benefit. It says this. A person who speaks in tongues is strengthened personally, but one who speaks a word of prophecy strengthens the entire church. One is for personal, right? One is for everybody else. Are you following me, church? You with me, all right? If you go on to read it, actually, it says, a person who speaks in tongues is strengthened personally, but. Did you know if you go and study that word "but," it can actually be translated to the word "and"? If you actually go and you study the New Testament, the word "but" is mentioned 2,792 times. How do I know that? I counted them last night. That's not true. I just have Bible software. But the word "but," but it depends on the translator. Instead, you can actually put the word "but," or you can put the word "and" in it. So if you read it again, what does it say? A person who speaks in tongues is strengthened personally, and one who speaks a word of prophecy strengthens what? The entire church. But it says, in verse 4, it says, it strengthens personally. In other words, it builds you up. How many would agree with understanding, with knowledge, do we build ourselves up? When you're going through a certain situation in your life, when you pop in that one worship song, when you listen to a word from God, does it not build you up and strengthen you? When you have a worship song in English and you got a word in English, you're going through something, you can pop in that one song, man, and it's going to make you feel a whole lot better, right? With understanding, it builds us up, right? Same with the Spirit. It builds us up, which is why we need both. Are you with me, church? Look at Ephesians chapter 6. Just flip to the right. To the right, Ephesians chapter 6. Look in verse 13. I think I went a little too far. What's going on now? Ephesians chapter 6. Come on, man. I should have put a bookmark in there. All right, here we go. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 13. It says this. This is talking about the armor of God, right? The armor of God. It says, therefore, put on every piece of God's armor. In other words, I just want to focus on that a second. The Bible says put on every piece, which means there's multiple pieces, right? In other words, what that means is if he's encouraging us to put on every piece, does that not mean that maybe there's some people that are walking around without all the pieces put on? And so he says, put on every piece of God's armor so you will be able to resist. You will be able. In other words, this is preparation, right? He's saying don't put on the suit when the battle comes. He's saying put on the suit before the battle even gets there. Are you following me, right? He says put on every piece of armor so that you're able to resist the enemy in the time of evil. Then after the battle, you will still be standing firm. Stand your ground, putting on the belt of truth, the body of armor of God's righteousness. For shoes, put on the peace that comes from the good news so that you will be fully prepared. In addition to all of these, hold up the shield of faith to stop the fiery arrows of the devil. Put on salvation as your helmet and take the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Now, verse 18, this is what I want to focus on. What does it say? Pray what? In the Spirit, which means what? Praying in tongues. It says, pray in the Spirit at all times and on every occasion. Stay alert and be persistent in your prayers for all believers everywhere. Friends, this is a piece of armor for you. This is a piece of armor for you. Praying in the Spirit, please get this. Praying in the Spirit is a piece of armor for you. I wonder how many that are in this room right now are walking around leading your family, leading your marriage, leading your business, leading your lifestyle without every piece of armor. And when you leave a place exposed, guess what? The enemy comes in to what? Steal, kill, and destroy. So why would you not want the Spirit of God that is part of your armor? Why? Because the Bible says, hey, get ready for battle. You're not battling against flesh and blood. You're battling against the enemy and wickedness and powers from on high. Get ready. The devil's going to come after you. So I pray in the Spirit at all times. Let me tell you, Psalm says pray him in the morning, pray him anew, pray at night. Every morning I pray in the Spirit. Every day, throughout the day I pray in the Spirit. I pray in the car. I pray in the shower. I try to pray brushing my teeth, but that didn't work too much. Should have gone up. It gets real messy. But I pray everywhere I go. I pray at night over my family. Everywhere I go, I pray in the Spirit. The reason why? Because no matter what the devil tries to throw at me, it's not going to be bigger than the Spirit that lives in me. I'm not going to give the devil a foothold to my situation. I'm going to have all the armor of God. How many of you are walking around with the armor of God, but not the whole armor of God on? Because you need this thing called the Holy Spirit. Are you with me, church? Amen? So whenever your flesh gets weak, what needs to become stronger? Your spirit. So your spirit needs to be built up. So it says in Jude chapter 20, you don't have to turn there, I'll just read it to you. But you, beloved, building yourselves up on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Spirit. So when somebody asks me, hey, B, why do you pray in the Spirit? It's real simple. It builds me up. It builds me up. That's why I pray. It builds me up. Why would you not want something that builds you up? Amen? If you're going through a situation, you're going through a storm, and you need some encouragement, why not? The greatest thing that helps me out is getting into a lone room. I pray in the Spirit, and it builds me up. Let me ask, is there anybody in here say, Pastor, man, I just don't need any more building up? I've had all the building up I can get, man. I don't need no more. I don't need no more encouragement. I don't need nothing, man. Don't give me no more building up. Is that anybody in here? That's what I thought. How many just need just the opposite? You need a whole lot and some more. Yeah, all right. You need some building up. This is what the Holy Spirit does for us, guys. This is what speaking in tongues, it's a gift from God that he desires for you. You need both. You need to pray to God and you need to pray to man in a language you understand and also in a language that you don't understand. How many know you don't need to understand it? You just need to pray to a God who you believe in because you know he's going to bring the results. Amen? That's what it's all about. So pray. It builds us up. It makes things possible. Have you ever gone through a storm? Anybody in here ever gone through a storm? Maybe you've had more than one storm hit you. Anybody have multiple storms hit you at once? Would you not agree that you need the armor of God in your life? Come on, let me know. We need the full, every piece of armor, amen, to be able to do and go against whatever the enemy is trying to throw at. So the Bible says that it will build you up. Why would we not want that? The reason why is because a lot of people have a hard time with point number three. Point number three is this. It's a choice. It's a choice. It's a choice. In other words, you choose whether you want to pray in the Spirit or not. Paul says, if I pray in tongues, It doesn't mean all of a sudden the Holy Spirit's going to put you in a trance and you're going to just start going and speaking in tongues uncontrollably like crazy, like you can't control it. No. That ain't the way it works. You know what I'm saying? You yield to the Holy Spirit. Listen to me, guys. This is where I get into the meat of it, okay? This is where I get into the meat of what I'm talking about. You do this and you receive it by faith. It is by faith. It is a faith jump, an audacious leap of faith to believe that you need something that's going to build your spirit up. You may be like, Pastor, man, I don't even know what it sounds like. That's a fair question. Or maybe if you've heard somebody speak in tongues, you're like, man, it just sounds like a whole bunch of gibberish. Yeah, I can tell you exactly what it sounds like. It sounds like when your little baby was couldn't even talk, but they were saying something, right? Now, there's not one person in here as a child that came out of your mother's womb that you started speaking in perfect diction. You came out, hey, mom, what's up? How you doing? This is a plethora of awesomeness, you know? I mean, you don't come out speaking in perfect diction, right? Let me tell you, this is exactly what it is and how it starts off. It's a new language, right? And it's just like when your kid is learning how to talk. This is happening right now in my household. Many of y'all know I got three girls. If you're new to Elevate, y'all pray for me. Three girls in the house. I got a five-year-old, I got an almost three-year-old, and a one-year-old. This is happening right now when we're sitting at the dinner table. And my one-year-old, whenever she wants something, she goes, atabatata. And everybody, me and my wife looking at each other like, what's she saying? I don't know what she wants. And we're like, I think she wants the mashed potatoes. So I hand her the mash. She's like, no. And then my daughter, Braylon, who's five, she'll look up and says, Daddy, she wants some bread. Duh. And she goes back down. We give her the bread and she's like, ha ha. So Braylon's, Raina speaks in tongues and Braylon has the gift of interpretation. You know what I'm saying? All right. Any other parents witness that in the house? You know what I'm talking about, yeah? It's like, da ba da ba da ba. This is, listen though, I want you to get this. I would use that as an example because this is exactly what it is. You're not going to understand it, but you do it by faith. Somebody shout, by faith. You do it by faith. Do you realize that you speak in English in understanding by faith? Have you ever walked into the room, maybe your spouse is praying or they're doing something and it sounds like two people in the room and two different conversations are taking place? That happened to anybody? Don't raise your hand if you did. I don't want to get you in trouble. All right? But the deal is, right, we find that sometimes. We find ourselves talking to God in the natural and in English, right? The Bible says, cry out to me. Cry out to me. Have you ever cried out to God believing for something, but it feels like your prayers can't even get through the ceiling of your house or your car? And you're sitting there praying to God, but what do? We speak with understanding in English by faith that our daddy God hears our prayers and he's going to answer the very thing that we need, right? How many know it's by faith? Same thing with wanting this gift that we all need. You receive it by faith, trusting that the words you may not understand is the very thing that you need the most. How many know a promise is a promise, amen? And our daddy God will always, always deliver. We pray out loud with understanding by faith. We want him to hear us. Same goes with our spirit. Don't be intimidated by it. The reason why we want to talk about this as a church is because it's so sensitive in the church today. But it's the one thing that'll help you more than anything is getting to know the Holy Spirit. Don't be intimidated. We believe in the Holy Spirit, but we also believe you can believe in the Holy Spirit and not be weird or goofy. You know what I'm saying? You ain't got to be weird. The Holy Spirit ain't like crazy cousin Uncle Eddie from Christmas Vacation. Where everybody wants to acknowledge him, but you don't want him anywhere around, right? We treat him like that sometimes, but you need the Holy Spirit in your, don't be intimidated. It's not like all of a sudden you're going to be in HEB this afternoon, and all of a sudden the Holy Spirit hits you, and you grab the, you know, the intercom mic, and you start shouting, shoot about a hundred about a kid, and you start getting the, it's not, and you start spinning and going, no. You in control. It's a choice. Somebody say it's a choice. You're in control. It is a choice. It ain't gonna be like, as an example. And it can be like you're walking out the door by the giving table, and all of a sudden a check pops out of your pocket and jumps into the giving table. And you're like, ah, I've been praying for this gift of giving. It just happened all on its own, right? How many know that ain't gonna happen and it never did, right? All pastors wish that it did, right? But anyway, but no, it's a choice. You're gonna have to make a choice to pull out that check, write a $2,000 to Elevate Kids. Y'all thought I was going somewhere, right? And put it in the bucket. Can I get an amen, all right? If we're gonna talk about it, might as well, right? But it did, how many know it was a choice? Are you hearing me, church? If you're going, listen, if you're going to pray in the Spirit, you're gonna have to open up your mouth and start talking in a language that you don't understand and trust that it's by faith. There we go. Boom, perfect time. Let's give him a hand. That was awesome. Thank you for helping me preach. So good. Just like that, you gotta open up your mouth. Now she's covering her mouth. How? It's awesome. Interpretation, please. Anthony? No? All right. So, that was perfect timing. So, here's the deal. If you desire this gift, are you hearing me, church? We need both. If you desire this gift, you're going to have to just open up your mouth and trust what is on the inside of you. And you start speaking it by faith. And you watch God make this happen. Now listen to me. There's a rumor that the devil, and I hate this rumor, is trying to spread in the church that if you start speaking in tongues, then you got this evil thing up inside you. And you got this evil spirit inside you because nobody else understands it. It must be in the enemy. How many know the devil will do anything to trick you to believe of any good thing from God? But how many know our daddy God does not give bad gifts? No gift from God is a bad gift. Every gift from God is a good gift. Amen? We need this in our lives. But how many know Jesus knew? See, the devil thinks he's fly. He thinks he's good. But Jesus knew exactly what he was going to try to throw into our minds and into denomination and into theological debates. If the devil, I already mentioned earlier, if he can get you debating the Holy Spirit instead of experiencing the Holy Spirit, then he's won in your life. But he knew this was going to happen. So he put something in scripture about it. Last scripture, look at Luke chapter 11. Luke chapter 11. Luke chapter 11. This is Jesus' response to the devil trying to throw it in people's faces that this gift is not a good gift. It says this in verse 11. You fathers, if your children ask for a fish, do you give them a snake instead? Or if they ask for an egg, do you give them a scorpion? Of course not. So if you sinful people know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more, church, shout that out, how much more? How much more will your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? Though, in other words, what this is saying, anybody who asks, it'll come through and it will happen. Anybody who asks about this. Now, I shared with you over the last 4 weeks that my experience in the Holy Spirit came at a young age, at 8 years old, younger than most people. Never forget, it was in Arizona. It's called the Ames Conference, an athletic conference. I'll never forget it. I was sitting in that moment and the preacher and the pastor told me, he said, Brandon, just say what you feel on the inside. It was a leap of faith moment for me. I'll never forget, I was sitting there and I was terrified, but I felt something in me that I knew that wouldn't make sense if I said it, but I said it by faith and I knew immediately that it was the power of God that hit me. And I began speaking in tongues and having a prayer language and praying in the Spirit. Changed my whole life. Now, I understand that my story is different than most of you. So I thought I'd share my wife's story. We talked about it. We talked about it a couple of days ago. I said, I'd like to share your story, babe. See, my wife and I, she grew up in a church to where they weren't against the Holy Spirit by any means, but they were never taught about this principle and this gift from God. And so I knew that going into marriage. She was the one I was called to marry. My boo, my love, my real. Yeah. Love her. But she didn't have, and I knew this was not going to be something that I forced on her. This is going to be something that I want her to desire. And there came a point in time while we were dating that it became a desire, and she was actually, some of y'all, I'm about to take y'all way back. Some of y'all know this. Anybody remember Gospel Bill in the house? Gospel Bill, few people. Woo! Yeah, man, Gospel Bill. Gospel Bill, she was out in Oklahoma at a camp called Dry Gulch Camp, and she was a counselor out there. And all of a sudden, it just hit her. She really desired this. So a couple of her friends started praying for her. They were laying hands on her, and they were praying, and then she heard this voice say, "Say this." And she took a leap of faith. She said what the voice said, and then she received the gift of speaking in tongues, and all of a sudden, when they stopped praying, Kristen, she goes, "Man, thank you for whoever said that to me." And they're like, "What you talking about? We didn't say nothing." That's when she realized it was either an angel or the voice of God, the Holy Spirit, that said, "Say this." But even though it spoke it to her, how many know it took a leap of faith to be able to make it out? Now, here's the deal. I know it doesn't happen that easy for everybody. No, it's not even that simpleness. No, there's many times where it doesn't happen right in the moment. I've talked to many to where it doesn't happen in the moment, and all of a sudden you convince yourself that maybe God didn't want it for me. No, what we just read, God says, anybody who asks can have it. You can have it too. But here's the thing. For some people, it's a stronghold in your mind. It's a stronghold. Because you spent so much time debating it that you're having a hard time receiving it. We got to let that stronghold go. It's like tithing. It's like tithing. When you immediately tithe, you don't see the benefit, right? At first. But how many know it comes? Amen? So here's my encouragement to you, church. My encouragement to you is simply this. It's not going to be weird. It doesn't have to be spooky in any way. But my encouragement to you, we're going to have a moment to where we pray together, but it doesn't have to happen right here. Get alone this week. Get in your car. Lock yourself in a room. Crank some worship music on. Crank a word, whatever you got to do, and just start praying. And start praying that the Holy Spirit is going to come upon you. And if you desire this gift, whatever you feel on the inside, just say it. Just let it go. If you desire a prayer language to your Heavenly Father, to God, a direct line to God, that's the way I look at it, man. Jesus, when I need a direct line to Jesus, I pray in the Spirit. And it builds me up. Now, here's the deal. For some, it happened with me this too. Whenever it happened, it felt like I was saying the same thing over and over and over and over again. And that's all right. Later on in ministry, I actually prayed. I asked a birthday present. How many know you can ask a birthday present from God every birthday, yeah? We get presents everywhere else. How come we can't ask one from God? Yeah, right? And I prayed that my prayer language would be extended, and God honored that. But it may sound like the same thing over and over again. Here's what I want you to get, church. Please hear me out. Don't focus so much on what you're saying, but focus on the power in what you're saying. And the power is that the Holy Spirit wants to come on you. It's a benefit for you. Paul said this. He says, "I pray that all of you have this gift." As your pastor, this is my prayer to you, as I pray that all of you have this gift. Why would you not want a gift from God that will build you up? Let's all stand together. Well, just bow your head and close your eyes. I feel a sweet presence in the room. It's just a presence of peace. I'm going to ask you just two questions. So number one is this. Maybe it's your first time here. Maybe you've been here before. You've never given your life to Jesus. The Holy Spirit is speaking to you. Tell you, friends, there's one thing that's going to get you to heaven, and that's a real relationship with Jesus Christ. that you've never given your life to Jesus, or you need to rededicate your life to Jesus, if I'm talking to you, we want to pray with you. Shoot your hand up. Don't be ashamed. Let me see and let us pray for you. 1, 2, 3. Shoot them up. Shoot them up. Thank you so much for those hands. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you for those hands. You can put them down. Heaven's rejoicing, church. Amen. Throwing a party. Not for my benefit, but just for yours. How many would say that this message today really spoke to you in a way that you needed? Let me see your hand. Shoot it up. Shoot it up. Come on, Jesus. Praise God. Thank you, guys, for your honesty. You can put your hand down. Here's what I want to do as a church. Is I want you to just take a moment. And as I pray for you, just believe that God can do it right now. But if it doesn't happen, it's no big deal. Get alone this week. And God is going to show up in your life. Amen? Let me just pray for you as a church. If you're comfortable with it, man, just hold your hands up just a little bit as a sign of surrender. Jesus, we thank you. We glorify you. We thank you for the hands that went up today. We pray right now in Jesus' name, Lord God, those that raise their hands, it's real easy. Accept Jesus into your life. Ask him to wash your sins clean, make you new, make you whole. Those that know right now, Father, Lord God, they desire to have a heavenly prayer language. Lord God, we just pray right now in Jesus' name that there is an overflowing amount of faith that is in their spirit right now, God. Father, give them the faith to believe and to know who you are. Holy Spirit, we pray right now you're in this place. You touch every single person who desires you the most, from the top of their head to the soles of their feet, Lord God. Those who desire a prayer language to pray into the Spirit to you, God, give them the faith to speak what is so inside of them, God. And Lord, we thank you. This is your church. We are your people. You are our God. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for being in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. And everybody said, amen. Come on, put your hands together one more time.
Somebody say, God is faithful. Say he's good. Do you believe that this morning? Amen, amen. Well, have you enjoyed this morning? Did you get something out of this? It thrills me to see that God can work and that he moves. And when we see so many hands lifted, recognizing that God has done something extraordinary, that they've had an encounter with the presence of God this morning. For us, that's what it's all about. Amen, amen, amen. Well, I want to remind you about a couple things real quick before we dismiss. Next week, Pastor mentioned it, but next week is our Elevate Worship weekend. So we're all Sunday next week. It's a great time to invite a friend. We're going to be doing some extended worship, and it really is. It's just so much fun. And so next week, y'all come ready to sing, to worship, shout, lift your voices in declaration of the Most High God. Amen? So get ready for that next weekend. We're really excited. We've been thinking about it for a long time, and we're ready. We're excited. And then the other thing I want to remind you about, Elevate Kids. These with the Elevate Kids sticker specifically are for our Elevate Kids fund. And let's knock this out today. Pastor mentioned next weekend we're making the transition. We're bringing our kids from the education building into the gathering place. And we've started ordering all the supplies that we need to make that transition happen. But there's just a few more things that we got to get knocked out. And so y'all help us ask the Lord what your part is to play in that so that we can knock that out this week and make it a smooth transition for our kids. Because here at Elevate, we believe in our kids. Amen? And then one more thing. If you're new to Elevate and you want to get involved serving somewhere, I believe one of the greatest demonstrations of just, an act of worship toward God is serving other people. Jesus said, I have come to be the greatest servant among you. And so when we come to Elevate, one of our greatest goals is to help you find a place to serve so that you can mirror what our Savior does, right? If you have a heart to serve, real simple, out in the lobby, on your way out, there's a table that says, All In. Natalie will be out there, and it's just a simple card you can fill out, say, I want to get involved. We're not going to make you wait 6 months to get involved. We want to get you involved. Depending on what area, we can get you involved next week. okay? But it starts by filling out one of those cards, and then she'll get a leader of an area in touch with you to let you know how you can get involved serving Elevate and the people that come here in that area, okay? So fill one of those out. Let me pray over you and pray over our tithes and offerings as we're dismissed today. Bow your heads. Father, we love you today, and we honor you. We thank you for the leadership of the Holy Spirit in our lives. We thank you, Father, that we don't have to go at this alone, but by the help of the Holy Spirit, we're seeing the extraordinary happen. Father, throughout this series, we've sensed the move of the Holy Spirit. We've sensed your presence doing something different and unique. For some of us, something we've never experienced before. And Father, right now, we just want to say thank you. Thank you for the move of your Holy Spirit at Elevate Church. Father, today I pray a blessing over your people, over the tithes and offerings that we've brought to you as an act of worship. We give it to you that way, Father, with joy in our hearts, Father. And I just pray a blessing on your people who give. Father, I pray your blessing on them as they go this week, Father. You've already gone before them, prepared their way, and they're going to have an incredible week because you're their God and their Savior. And we thank you for it in Jesus' name. And everybody in here said, amen, amen, amen. We love you. We'll see you next week.
Hey, guys, thank you so much for joining us today on our online community here with Elevate Church. I want to challenge you that if you haven't signed up for our mailing list, please do. It's a great way for us to get to know you and for you to get to know us and see all the great things that are happening here in the city of Houston and how we're reaching other people in the community. Also, I want to challenge you, if this ministry has tugged at your heart at all and you want to help us reach more people, I challenge you to go to elevatepeople.tv and hitting the giving tab. Thank you guys so much for joining us today. We love you, and we'll see you next week.